வணக்கம் ஃப்ரெண்ட்ஸ், ஆன் பிஹாஃப் ஆஃப் தி சதர்ன் இந்தியா சேம்பர் ஆஃப் காமர்ஸ் அண்ட் இண்டஸ்ட்ரி சிக்கி, ஐ டேக் அ கிரேட் பிளெஷர் இன் இன்வைட்டிங் இன் வெல்கமிங் அம்பாசிடர் கேசவபாணி டு டுடேஸ் ப்ரோக்ராம். ஐ ஆல்சோ டேக் கிரேட் பிளெஷர் இன் இன்வைட்டிங் இன் வெல்கமிங் ஈச் ஒன் ஆஃப் யூ டு டுடேஸ் ப்ரோக்ராம் அஸ் வெல். யூ ஆர் வெரி கிளாட் தட் யூ குட் ஜாயின் அஸ் டுடே. அஸ் மோஸ்ட் ஆஃப் யூ வுட் பி அவேர், சிக்கி ஹேஸ் கம்ப்ளீட்டட் 110 இயர்ஸ் ஆஃப் சர்வீஸ் to industry, government, and society. During these years, we have conducted several programs, and I've also invited several eminent guests to address our programs. Invariably, our guests address us for about 20 to 25 minutes and restrict their address to just their area of expertise. We, however, felt that our guests have much more to offer than just their area of expertise. We felt that our guests could share with us their life's journey, the various points that have assisted them to reach where they are, including their inputs for the next generation as well as society. That is how we came up with the concept of Sikhi 360. We are extremely glad that we have since conducted 11 extremely successful sessions of Sikhi 360 since we started in October of last year. We are extremely glad that today is our 12th session, and each one of our sessions have had a renowned guest, a guest who's well known globally. Today as well, we have a renowned guest in Ambassador K. Kesavapani. We're extremely glad that he could join us today. Before I go over the slide that you see in front of you, I would like to draw your attention to the names of two of our executives listed in the bottom of this slide. I request you to please take down their numbers, and if any of you have any difficulty in reconnecting during the course of today's call, please feel free to give them a call and they will be glad to assist you reconnecting. As I was saying, Sikhi 360 is a new foray for us, building on the experience of our seminars. We wanted to give it a name that depicts a multidimensional perspective, as this program is a multidimensional perspective giving event. We orient this event as a lively discussion with our eminent guests, and each of our guests are experts in their fields who share with us their all-round paths to excellence. We look for our guests. We have a stringent criteria to invite our guests. We look for guests who have had at least 4 decades of experience, both in their respective industry as well as society contribution. And of course, this is an apolitical event. The format that we follow in Sikhi 360, for those of you who are not aware, is we have 5 sections that we go over. We first talk about our guests' expertise. We then go into our guests' organization and the role within their organization. Third, we talk about our guests' career path. Fourth, we talk about our guests' inputs for the next generation. And finally, we talk about our guests' inputs for society. We certainly encourage you, the audience, to participate along. There are 2 very basic guidelines that we follow as part of this program. Number one is we want our guests to be at comfort at all points of time so that we are able to re-invite our guests at any point of time to our programs. And secondly, we would like you, the audience, to be able to gain from this. So please feel free to share your inputs, comments, questions on our online chat, and our Sikhi 360 team will be glad to moderate it and have it answered during the course of the program. I'd also like to share with you that there are 2 important areas that we are addressing as part of today's session. One is a new addition to today's program that was given life by one of our committee members, Professor Murugavel. So we are starting it from this program onwards. So that's a surprise. I'd like you to be a part of that, which will immediately follow the discussion session that we have with Ambassador. And there's also a second message that we would like to share with you at the end of that. So look forward to your being with us through the entire program. Next slide, please, Pawani. Having spoken to you about Sikhi 360, I would now like to share a few words about our esteemed guest for today, Ambassador K. Kesavapani. His father was from Vellore. His father was born in Vellore and moved to Singapore over 100 years ago. Ambassador Pani, as what he's frequently referred to, was born and grew up in Singapore. He did his BA honors at the University of Malaya. And he has an MA area studies from the University of London's School of Oriental and African Studies, where he specialized in the Southeast Asian and Cambodian, where he specialized in Southeast Asia and the Cambodian conflict. He significantly was Singapore's High Commissioner to Malaysia during a very trying period of time that we will be talking about in the course of today's call. He was also Singapore's permanent representative to the UN in Geneva and concurrently served as ambassador to Italy and Turkey. He is the chairman of the Abdul Kalam Vision Society that is based in Singapore. He is also the governor on the board of Singapore International Foundation and president of the Singapore India Association. He is also director of the Institute of Southeast Asian Studies in Singapore. He has been member of the Singapore Mediation Center's International Panel of Mediators, member of the Energy Institute of Singapore, term trustee of Singapore India Association, member of the Rotary Club of Raffles City. He has significantly been executive committee member of the Dyslexia Association of Singapore. Again, we'll be talking about that in the course of today's conversation. And he's a visiting faculty at the Singapore Management University. Ambassador Pani has written several books, some of them being From Estate to Embassy, Memories of an Ambassador. Secondly, Negotiating the Korea-Singapore FTA, a case study. Third, APEC at 20, Recall, Reflect and Remake. And fourth, Rising India and Indian Communities in East Asia. Of course, there's another book of his that's scheduled to be coming out soon, and he will be talking about that in the course of today's call as well. With those few words, I would like to take this opportunity to warmly welcome Ambassador Pani again to today's program. Vanakkam, Ambassador, eppadi irukkeenga?
Vanakkanga, nalla irukkeenga. Namat pagi, as we say in our language here. We also say ni hao in Chinese. We say in Tamil, vanakkam. So we have four languages to greet.
Thank you for joining us. Getting into the discussion, you've been referred to as a diplomat's diplomat, Ambassador. What skills do you feel are required for a diplomat? And how does one acquire these skills? You've also put in a good amount of time at Kirby. How has this multicultural, multiracial environment shaped you?
That tagline, diplomat's diplomat, was coined by a very friendly journalist friend of mine. I really don't know what that means. But I suppose it means that a person who is able to reach out as widely as possible and be accessible to as widely as possible. So I myself don't give too much credit for that, but if he wants that, I will take it. Kirby was a turning point in my life because after my tertiary education in Malaysia, I was deciding whether to do law or to do law. And suddenly this scholarship came to go and do teacher training in Kirby. So who wouldn't want to go at the age of 20? Who wouldn't want to go and enjoy an overseas experience? So that's how I came to go to Kirby, and it was 2.5 years of sheer bliss. Everything paid for, courtesy of the Malaysian government, very good teachers, very good intermingling. So it was we've always in Malaysia and Singapore, we have been used to mixing with races, but here was something separate. You're in a virtual, if I use the word colony, by yourself, 6,000 miles away, and how you interact. So that became a microcosm of a multicultural society. And I would say that has been a lifelong learning experience.
Our next two points are oriented towards a very famous, popular gentleman, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, who has been considered the father of Singapore and has played a significant role in making Singapore what it is today. So the first point about Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, you stated, Ambassador, that Mr. Lee Kuan Yew's speech left a lasting impression on you and served as a catalyst for a life-changing decision. Also, Lee Kuan Yew has transformed Singapore from just another colonial post to a globally financial power center. Can you elaborate on these two points?
Well, I was then a student in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, and at the university. And when I went back to Penang, where my wife was teaching, I heard about this gentleman coming to Penang and going to give a public talk. This was a period when we were expanding Malaya, Singapore, Brunei, Sarawak, and Sabah into one unit, which now is called Sabah. So this Mr. Lee Kuan Yew was preaching these ideas where you can have a bigger unit and, you know, and on basis of multiculturalism, multiracialism, meritocracy, and you know, all the other attributes of nationhood. So when he spoke for about 1.5 hours in heavy rain, and nobody stirred, nobody just went away. They just stood in rain and listened to him. I also listened to him. And that was my first leap into socialism, so to speak. And this is the kind of society that I always have been wanting. And so when Mr. Lee came along and gave this vision of a multicultural, multiracial, multilingual society, I had no hesitation to make the jump. And that's how I came to Singapore. And that's where I have been for the last 40 odd years. And by the way, may I say today is Mr. Lee Kuan Yew's birthday, 16 September.
Yes, I was going to say that. That was my next point. Thank you for bringing it up. And being Mr. Lee Kuan Yew's birthday, September 16th, he would have been, if he was alive, he would have been 98 today, if I'm not mistaken. And may I take this opportunity to raise a toast in his memory, Ambassador, if you could kindly join me. You've worked particularly closely with Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, Ambassador, and this is during the time that there was a lot of conflict in the Singapore-Malaysia relationship. It was extremely strained. This particular relationship is what got you very close to Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, but you managed that situation, the strained situation, and were able to mend and smoothen the relationship for the benefit of both nations. How was this, and how was it working with a very towering personality like Mr. Lee Kuan Yew?
I can describe that I was very close to Mr. Lee Kuan Yew because he was always very, very cautious and careful about who he deals with. That's his style. But in policy terms, you had to engage him, he had to engage you. And if you're caught out telling a tall story, he will find out very fast, and you will be out of the room very fast. So you have to be on attention. And somehow or other, the reason why at that particular time I was selected to go is that I was from Malaysia, so I knew the background of people. I also knew the language, Malay language, and also, you know, how the Malaysians operate. So these are things that, you know, came in useful, and I was able to interpret this to Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. But I must also say, he will be the first person to say he did it all by himself. He was very fortunate, and Singapore was very fortunate to have a team. And that team included Dr. Goh Keng Swee, the finance minister, also became defense, Mr. Rajaratnam, the foreign policy minister, and a few other ministers. And it was a collective effort. So that's why we say Mr. Lee is not the founder of Singapore, he is the primus inter pares, first among.
There was a statement made during your actions at the Uruguay negotiations. And that statement was, quote, "Thieves stealing in the night," unquote. This was made by a Third World Network representative. Could you please elaborate on that?
The Uruguay round negotiations had gone on and on and on. That's why it's called round, you see. And there was no end to it. Two things happened. I have no economic background, no trade background. So my permanent secretary who hosted me, I asked him, why are you sending me there to Geneva? He said, no, you have something that I know that you don't. So what I had was the ability to reach out and bring people around the table to form consensus. As you know, the WTO operates on consensus. If one person objects, you're finished. So to bring 160 people around the table to agree on a single text, or something, quite a job. So the reason is I was able to get both the people in the third world, in the first world, and in the middle. So I was able to come. That's why the term thieves, like thieves in the night. I mean, we did it so quickly, and it was an Indian diplomat who was in Ghat, Arif Hussain, and I worked very closely, and we managed to get it. You know, it's a huge undertaking, about 15 different texts, getting all put. And we also brought in China. That was the time that the Chinese negotiation to bring China into it, and Taiwan, by the way. So it was quite a complex thing. And Sir Raghavan, the representative of the Third World Network, you know, he said this could not have been done unless it was done in the darkness of the night.
Our last question in the first section, that is on your expertise. We decided to bring this on because this was a very interesting question. Importantly, because it brings in another dimension to your journey. You have, of course, written several books. The royalties and proceeds from sale of your first 300 signed books were donated to the Dyslexia Bursary Fund. And this was meant to support financially low-income families. Involvement in dyslexia stands out and seemingly unconnected to the rest of your activities. Why in particular were you involved with this cause?
That's a nice story. See, my Rotary friend, Jimmy Daruwala, Dr. Jimmy Daruwala, he was going to start. So my wife is a trained teacher in special needs children. So they invited her for the meeting. But somebody had to take her there, and I was the driver. So I took her, I was the driver, went there. So before I knew, I was in the committee. So that's how I became, and then of course, I was instrumental in getting the first building for the for Dyslexia Association. And Dr. Jimmy Daruwala from Mumbai, he made a fantastic work. And we grew from one small center. Today we have 13 centers. And the reason why we got a head start was Mr. Lee Kuan Yew himself coming out and saying, I'm also mildly dyslexic. So that gave us additional runway. But coming to why I donate, I have my mentor is the late Mr. S. R. Nath. So he told me, whatever you do, have a social element to it. So that is why I said, God has given me whatever is needed. So just so we raised $13,000 at the sale, the 300 books. And you want to talk about the book later, my coming book, I will tell you later.
Sure. We now move on to the next section, which is the organization and our guest's role within the organization. Ambassador, we often see international forums are such that interests of bigger and wealthier countries are what prevail at all times. How can small countries like Singapore survive such an environment? And for that matter, even countries like India, which are developing in nature, how can they also make an impact in such forums?
India has always been making an impact. Always, in fact, it's good for all the third world countries in a very big way. But in an environment like WTO or even UNCTAD and all, you have to look for the broader so that everybody gains. If everybody gains, then you have a win-win situation. But if you say only I want to gain, that won't do. So you don't have to think you're a small country. You have to punch above your weight. That's what we tell our budding diplomats. Always punch above your weight. And don't be constrained that you are, you know, you're a small country. Tommy Koh, I'll give you an example of a small country gentleman. Ambassador Tommy Koh, he became the chairman of the Climate Change Convention 10 years ago. And, you know, he really made an impact on the climate conversation. And we have several people like that who have made contributions to international relations, etc. So I would disagree that it's a size that matters. It's not. It's what you are able to contribute.
Ambassador, before we go on to the next point, can I request you to kindly keep your microphone closer to you, because I think some of our audience are not able to catch your speaking clearly.
Okay.
Yeah. Ambassador, you have established two centers at the Institute of Southeast Asian Studies. You wanted researchers to give their views without any fear or favor. How successful were you in your attempt on this?
Well, I was director of the Institute of Southeast Asian Studies for 10 years. I was the first non-scholar, diplomat turning into a scholar. So it was, at the beginning, people were, even the scholars were a bit worried whether I was coming to be the master's voice at the Institute. So I had to establish that, you know, nobody is a master's voice. We say and we mean what we are. In fact, the credit goes to Dr. Goh Keng Swee, who was responsible for the setting up. He did not establish it as part of any university. He said it should be ICES or Institute, should be sui generis, should be free to make out his voice. So that is how we have functioned. So we set up two centers. One was the ASEAN Studies Center. ASEAN Studies Center, ASEAN itself is a political animal, more or less looked after by the 10 countries. So we needed somebody or some organization which would be able to speak and say, oh, it is what it is. So we established that, and we got a very good set of scholars. And of course you're backing them, so they can say what you know. I think there was one example of one of my scholars who did a piece on climate change. So he was going to be pulled up. I had to just defend him, and I said, no, climate change is coming. You better listen to what he says. The other one I'm particularly proud of is the Nalanda Sri Vijaya Center. We felt that, you know, the connection with India has not been well studied. The last time anybody paid great attention was Nilakantha Sastri and R.C. Majumdar. After that, there was a bit of a lapse. So when the opportunity came, we set this up and we did a lot of research. Unfortunately, external politics got in the way. It became something else.
Our next three questions are about the Singapore-India Connect. I'm particularly interested in the first one. You have a personal connect, Ambassador, with Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. Your brother was with the Indian National Army under Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. You've also commissioned a book on Netaji. But when we look at Netaji's perspective today in people's minds, there's a very different perspectives that are emerging out, and perhaps even taking it on the wrong side of the coin. What kind of person was Netaji, and in your opinion? And if India had followed his path, how different would we have been?
I wouldn't hazard a guess on the last point, but I will say what Netaji meant for overseas Indians, particularly the Indians in Singapore and Malaysia. Many of us have never seen India, had no connection with India. But when Netaji came to Singapore and made a public speech, women were throwing their jewelry at him. they were throwing money at it. And young men, you know, went to enlist. Why? There was this sense of nationalism. And that nationalism was very important for us because we want to be connected. And liturgy made the connection for us. And so, as far as we are concerned, liturgy, the ideas of liturgy was what we were looking for, what we were looking for. Of course, you know, the other things came in. Why I came to the book, there's a book called A Gentleman's Word, written by a scholar friend of mine, Nilanjana Sengupta. Now, this was the suggestion again of the late Mr. S.R. Nathan, our president, who said there's a lot of stories about how he escaped through submarine and this, that, and all. But there is no book on his legacy. So I got this lady to write this book on his legacy, and it really will tell you what liturgy is.
Our next question has two parts to it. The first is, you have stated, Ambassador, that India lost its opportunity to project its soft power in the world. How do you think this would have benefited India? And don't you think India can do it at least now? That's the first part. And the second part, we have one of our executive committee members, Mr. K. Shankar, who would like to ask a question of you. Mr. Shankar, can you please go ahead?
Can you hear me, President?
Yes,
please go ahead.
Could you please call me Pani? And
Mr. Ambassador, good morning. How significant is Singapore's role in the government's Look East policy?
Shall I first give you my first comments? You know, when overseas Indians came, settled in Malaysia, in Malaya, Singapore, we were more or less discarded. We had no official links with the government. And this went on for a long while. Now, look at China. China continued with the overseas Chinese Indians. So there was a connectivity which went on. And when the struggle for independence, it was Sun Yat-sen who did raise a lot of money. So the connection was there. But in the Indian case, there was no such connection for a long, long time. It was only after Mr. Modi came to power, he realized, he recognized the value of having this connection. And he brought in laws, and he brought out the NRI, you know, the OCI, all kinds of things. So that is why we feel now we have a stronger link. The Look East policy, I'll tell you a story. For a long while, people did not give enough credit to Lee Kuan Yew in his approach to India. So I commissioned a book by Dr. Ray, and he wrote this book, Look East to Look West. And consistently, Lee Kuan Yew has been telling the Indians to look east and to look west. Until then, India was more inside, and then maybe non-aligned and all that. So that book brought out the real Lee Kuan Yew. There is a cartoon where India is prostrate, and Lee Kuan Yew is whispering in the ears of India, get up, and find your place in the sun. You know? And now that's happening. I hope I've answered your question.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. The next question is an exciting question of sorts. The Singapore-Tamil Nadu connect, that connect is massive, it's huge. There's a tremendous number of Tamilians who have made Singapore their home. There are a tremendous number of Tamilians who are visiting Singapore. And there are a number of Singapore Indians who also visit Chennai and Tamil Nadu. Ambassador, how do you think Tamil Nadu should further engage with its diaspora in Singapore, many of whom are third and fourth generation Singapore Indians, and who visit Tamil Nadu once in 2-3 years. Similarly, what do you think Singapore Tamils could offer Tamil Nadu?
Two things. In terms of culture, terms of culture, we have come to a stage where we have been able to develop our standard of culture to not equal, but at least to better. We have two organizations. One is the Singapore Indian Fine Arts, and then we have the Arts. These are organizations. There are any number of organizations. So there must be a cultural connect continuum to this linkage. In the economic area, I would suggest that it has been ad hoc. Delegations go, delegations come. But there has to be a more sustained effort. And this is where the place where I am sitting, Singapore Indian Chamber of Commerce and Industry, we have been trying to make this connection. So on both sides, if we increase further the vigor and vitality of making this connection, that there would be. The other thing I would think is you have to bring along the Chinese. The Chinese in Singapore who are very comfortable in going to China, but not so comfortable in coming to Tamil Nadu or India as a whole. Why? Why? Have we made the kind of things that are necessary in terms of creature comforts, in terms of facilities, facilitating trade, etc.? So this is an area I think we need to look at.
We have a question from another guest from Singapore, Mr. Rajaram. I'm not sure if he is online. Mr. Rajaram, are you online?
There are two Rajarams, at least.
Okay, so I guess he is not online. But his question to you, Ambassador, was this is Mr. Rajaram from NUS in Singapore. His question goes, quote, your biography documents your journey from Malayan estates to your entry into Singapore's Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Your beginnings were obviously modest, but do you think there was something about growing up in a Malayan estate that equipped you particularly well for life and career as an ambassador later, unquote? This incidentally is the first question of our third section, going into your career path.
Thank you, Mr. Rajaram, a good friend of mine. He has done wonderful work in promoting Tamil language, one of the leading proponents. And to answer the question, I am a great believer in karma. And I'm also a great believer in Vidhi. So in my forthcoming book, I wrote a chapter, Vidhi or Karma. This will explain. It was my Vidhi to be born in a rubber estate. And that was during Japanese occupation. You know, when you had to go through all kinds of things. My responsibility in the family was to, that was my first business, to look after six goats, family goats. And the goats had to be milked and then sold. So you see, I'm also a businessman at heart. That's Vidhi. Vidhi will take you where it's supposed to take you. And in my case, from my state, they took me to town, to schools, Kirby, and then came to, I had a point where I could have done law, or I could have done something else. But then Vidhi made me go into the diplomacy, and that's where I. Karma is, on the other hand, something that, what do you do? What have you done? Past life, present life, that will determine karma. So it's an interesting chapter. For my own satisfaction, I wrote this chapter in the coming book, which we'll talk later.
You were ambassador to several countries, including Australia, Turkey, Geneva, Switzerland, of course, Jordan, Indonesia, Russia, the UK, and of course, Malaysia. That's a whole lot of countries that you have seen and lived in. But is there any country that you wished you had been sent to, but never was? And if there was a country, what's your reason behind that?
Well, Well, I was not ambassador in all these countries. Indonesia was number two, Russia was number two, UK was number two. Then when I went to what do you call it, Geneva, then I was ambassador in Geneva, POMREP, and accredited ambassador to Turkey and Italy. So that's two different things. The country that I would really have liked to have been is Bhutan. Bhutan. I have a special relationship with Bhutan, partly because a very good friend of mine, his name is Benji, Ambassador Benji Dorje. But more importantly, the people of Bhutan are a special kind of people in my view. They were willing to share, willing to. And the king, the king's father, he was the first person I've come across who said, he told his people, take my power from me now, before I go off, and then there's all kinds of shenanigans, take my power now. So his son was about 26 or so, but he told the people, look, I'm giving the power to you. Not only that, because the people were not happy. The politicians are, you know, so what he made the politicians do, he got the constitution, copies made, and made them go to every village in Bhutan and explain the rights and responsibilities of a citizen, this, that, and all. So this is something that, you know, I've never seen happening in any village. I've been several times to Bhutan and hope to go again. So that is why I want, but then people said, no, you're going to then I landed in Kuala Lumpur.
Coming to one of the books that you have been involved with, you co-edited a book called Nagapattinam to Swarnad Vipa, Reflections on the Chola Naval Expeditions to Southeast Asia. This book included translations of contemporary Tamil and Sanskrit inscriptions relating to Southeast Asia and the Chola Kingdom. Could you elaborate on these ancient trade connections? Also, you have recently been involved with Rajendra Chola's 1000th birth anniversary. Certainly would like to know your comments on what you think about these events.
At heart, I'm a historian, diplomat, teacher, but at heart, I'm a historian. So when you're a historian, you start looking at certain things. For example, how was it possible for the Cholas to cross the seas? At that time, there were restrictions about crossing the seas. And how did they go to Sikandaram in Kedah? How did they go to Java? You know, and Rabindranath Tagore, Guruji has written about this. So these were things that were in my mind. And what we did was have a major conference, early interactions between South and Southeast Asia. That was a major conference. And the person who stood by me in organizing this conference was Mr. Subbaiya, M.B. Subbaiya, retired chairman of the Cholamandalam group. So you see the word Chola, the connection. So he funded this whole conference, and he was there for the 3 days. So, you know, I owe a lot of great debt to him. Now, why I did this, because we must know where we come from in order to go where we are. And right now, that voyage is now taking us back to India. And it's a circular argument. Now, after doing it with the English version, I told myself, Cholas means Tamil. So it's no use talking about Cholas in English alone. Why not have a translation? So that's how we came across this book. We made this book. It's the only, and I'm proud to say, it's the only book in Tamil published by any university or research institute.
Ambassador, I have to request you again to kindly speak a little closer to the microphone.
Okay.
Really hear you. Thank you. We now go into the fourth section of our discussion, which is on your inputs for the next generation. Towards this, we have one of our committee members again. He's the chair of our supply chain management committee, Mr. Naveen Kolathur, who would like to ask a question of you. Mr. Naveen Kolathur, can I request you to please go ahead? Bhavani, is Mr. Naveen Kolathur online?
Yeah, sorry, I had difficulty in unmuting. Yes. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot, Ambassador. The question, I have lived in Singapore. I still report to the regional office in Singapore. So my connection with Singapore is a lot more, right? So one of the things that always amazes me in Singapore is the efficiency. It is not ad hoc. It's a very structured process, and it is somehow ingrained from the school system all the way into society. What would be some of the things that a large nation like India could develop that efficiency mindset? I call it an efficiency mindset. I have colleagues who report to me sitting in Singapore. But the efficiency factor has always amazed me. So I'd like to get your thoughts on what can we, India as a nation, do in order to develop that efficient mindset.
That's a very difficult thing. Firstly, Singaporeans and I personally don't think Singapore has anything to teach India. India is an ancient civilization with all kinds, and it has got its own set of problems. What I rather say, share Singapore's experience. That's the word I would use, rather than teach or learn from or whatever it is. Now, again, as our chairman has said, it's a small place. Singapore is a small place. Half of Chennai has the most, and easier to manage. Communication becomes almost instant. And so do you have. So let me give you an example. I mean, Mr. Naveen, you will know Jurong. Jurong is in the western part of Singapore. Marshland, nothing there. Then we had a Dutch economist, Dr. Winsemius. He told Dr. Goh Keng Swee to develop this Jurong. People were laughing at us. People said, "What for? It's all marshland." But Dr. Goh Keng Swee believed in Dr. Winsemius and made that a model industrial estate. Now that industrial estate is one of the icons of industrial office management anywhere else. So when the Chinese opened up, Deng Xiaoping came to Singapore, and one of the places he went was to Jurong. He saw what had been done with this little place, and overnight became the magnet for international companies to come in. So what he did, he went back and told his people, go south and learn, and if possible, surpass. So that is the beginning of the Chinese, modern Chinese economic miracle. So it was a small plot of land, but with efficiency, with with foresight, it can be done. In fact, Tamil Nadu also has an industrial park, and it has attracted a lot of particularly automobile related companies. So we can expand like that. And if there is anything that we could share, we will be happy to share. For example, we have a biopolis. A biopolis, there are about nearly 100 companies there doing all sorts of in that particular sphere. Then we have some other thing. Then, of course, you have a Chennai Industrial Estate, which, it's called Changi Industrial Estate, but we sometimes joke and say it's Chennai Industrial Estate, because a lot of talented people are there. So there's a lot we can share. That is the word I will use. And I'm sure Mr. Naveen, you'll agree.
Ambassador, our next question is, we'd love to hear from you about the origin and purpose of this quote that you have mentioned, which goes, quote, helping to save people from falling through the cracks, unquote.
You see, when I became president of the Singapore Indian Association about 8 years ago, I found that people were doing the usual things. For example, bursaries, scholarships, this, that, and all. When I came in, I said, no, let's look at social issues. And the social issues are, you know, because Singapore had grown rich very fast. So we had a lot of rich people, with a lot of middle class, but there were also people in this thing. So we needed to pay attention to this group of people who needed to be helped. And so what we did was to start this, it's under the Singapore Indian Association Welfare Fund. This program is called Helping People from Falling Through the Cracks. So the moment we hear about somebody, either through education, cannot pay fees, cannot this, or the father is sick, the family is this, we go in and help. We are able to do this because we raise our own money. We raise our own money through other things. Of course, the Singapore government is very, very, you know, supportive and with all sorts of social programs. The only thing is, if you're doing it on your own, you're able to do it faster. You're able to do very fast, respond very fast. Otherwise, you know, there is an element of bureaucratic steps you have to take. So that is why I came through. And the most recent case I can tell you, this was a family. And we came to know that the mother was widowed. The father died 3 years ago. And then three children. And they all had to be educated. So for us, education is the key. As Senior Minister Tharman Shanmugaratnam puts it, it's the escalator to take you where you have to go. So when it comes to education, we overbend and say, we will fund it. And whether they pay us or not, we don't go ask, you must spend it. We just give them and tell them, when you have done what you have done, pay back to society. That's how it is.
Going into your diplomatic days, you succeeded in banning smoking during the GATT meetings. How did you achieve this when most governments failed in doing this?
Well, I come from a country where smoking is antisocial. Lee Kuan Yew can't stand smoking anywhere near him. So when I went to Geneva, I saw people, you know, smoking away. I was a smoker myself. I used to enjoy Havana cigars, a glass of brandy. But when I went there, I said, look at the harm it's causing other people. You know? And, you know, trade meetings can go on for hours and hours and hours. And these fellows came and said, no, we can't think without smoking. I said, rubbish. You can think better without smoking. So overnight, I was chairman of the WTO General Council, the first inaugural chairman. So I said WTO will start off with a no smoking policy. So 75% of the people agreed. There were some diehards, but later they had to come over. And I think it remains the only international organization which has a ban on smoking.
In fact, we had Dr. V. Shanta of the Adyar Cancer Institute as one of our earlier guests. And I asked her this question about why can't we move forward with a ban on smoking, an outright ban on smoking. So for that, she said, if there is a will, there is a way. And then she dropped it at that. That answered a lot. Ambassador, you have a passion for the past, but at the same time, you didn't want it to be thrust upon today's youth. How do we make today's youth value their past, whether it is their heritage or their culture? And so that they understand that they have to preserve our heritage and culture for posterity to come.
Okay. First thing we must do is we must let the academics write their big, big, thick, thick books, which no youngster these days is going to read. Youngsters are not reading books. Every whatever information is got from the internet. So we have decided we are really going to reach out to the youngsters. We have to bring books, bring out books. I just brought out a book on Abdul Kalamji. It's a small booklet, We chose 30 of his quotations, his most famous quotations, and we printed it and distributed. Now we are going into second print. It has Tamil, English, Hindi. Soon we'll have Malayalam, Telugu, and any other Bengali, any other languages. So you must appeal to the ministers. Back when I was at ISIS, we used to give the ministers thick, thick books. One day, the then Prime Minister, Mr. Goh Chok Tong, was asked, do you read those books? He said, one of these days I'll read. I stopped giving the books. So what we did, we gave synopsis. So we tell the secretary, if your principal likes this book, we will give. Otherwise, we won't give. Because what's the point of, you know, publishing and giving, and it's lining on the table. So you have got to think what all the younger generation wants. Like my sons, they say, we don't read the newspapers. Why? I got everything from the, you know. So we have to rethink. And
our last question in the next generation section is about volunteering. Ambassador, is there merit in starting volunteer activities earlier in life? For example, should youth start their careers getting themselves involved in volunteer activities like what you've been involved in? And what do you think government should do in order to encourage volunteering?
There are two differences, volunteering and career. You know, volunteering is volunteering, but to make it into a career, that it is a different thing. Now, volunteering can be done.
My question was about how do we make it part of one's career development itself, rather than waiting for it to be done only at the later ages, to be able to do it on an ongoing basis.
Volunteering can be done at any time. I get people, I get youngsters all the time saying we want to volunteer for this, we want to volunteer for that. It can be done at any time, at any age, but you must have the inclination and the support. And you must give them the support. And that's one thing, volunteering. But if you want to make it into a career, then it becomes, we have what's called an organization which helps people who want to make volunteering a career, especially now with all the problems that are emerging. We need a whole slew of volunteering activities, and for this you have to have training. You have to be able to have courses at the university level, at the polytechnic level, at all levels. So it's one and the same, but at the same time, and we are very fortunate here in Singapore, volunteering is taken very seriously, and all the effort that we, no, but I tell you, the government is very smart. Right? Singapore government very smart. If they don't do it, if we don't get volunteers to do it, they have to do it. They're not. So why not get the people to do it, and then you get them, just like you can donate. But the moment you donate, you get in return 1.5 value of income tax. And so I used to think, hey, my government very, very good, very generous. They are making sure you do their work for them. They give you, and you do the work for them.
We now come to the fifth section of our discussion on your inputs for society. We have a student joining us today. His name is Beryl Jason, and he's doing his final year IT at SVC in Chennai. Beryl, are you online? If so, please go ahead.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, please.
Okay. So Singapore is a small country. So it's easy to maintain Singapore's cleanliness. But what do you think it's for it to be implemented in a large country like India? So how can we keep India clean? Like, for example, if Singapore is a small country, so it's easier to keep it clean. But how can we implement it in India?
My friend, I don't agree. Singapore is a small country and India is a big country. I don't agree. Because you break up India into small parts. You know?
Yeah.
You break up Chennai into small parts. You take a small part and do your volunteering there. Make it a model. And then you will replicate the model everywhere. So the point is, it's, you look at Ramakrishna Mission, right? Just look at Ramakrishna Mission.
Okay.
Yeah, they're all over. They're all over India, they're in Singapore. Oh, because they take a small piece of territory and they provide the services. It's the providing the services that makes the organization, that makes what you're going to give. So the moment you have this mindset, you know, you're a big country, we can't do anything, then you're lost. So you as a teen, I will tell you this story, in real story. In Singapore, one day a lady was going in a car and he saw some workers standing in the rain. So he went up to them and gave them an umbrella. She had two umbrellas. Gave them two umbrellas. That made her think, why not start an umbrella movement? Now, banned umbrella movement from a small intersection of a road. It has become nationwide. It has become nationwide. So start small, think small. But as Mother Teresa said, I want this Jason to think, we all can't do great things, but we can all do small things with great love. That is the essence. You know, that is the answer. That is what Abdul Kalamji also has said. Do small, you know. It's in your capacity to do small. If you do small and the conditions are right, it will be okay. But if, on the other hand, you say, oh, India is too big, nothing can be done. And there are many examples I can give you how India has, you know, has spread the world. In fact, you go back to history, you go back to the, you know, why are we celebrating the Chola period? Why are we looking at Rajendra Chola? Do you know the, you know, that in terms of engineering, building, in terms of medicine, science, there's so much there in there. But unfortunately, we had a period when we became the so-called the Dark Ages. The Dark Ages. We forgot what in there was. There is an excellent book on the tradition of medicine of India. It's a small book written. And I tell you, the Western world took chunks of that from that book and marketed it, copyrighted it. Tulasi, Murungaka, you name it. You know, now it's regarded as Western products. Actually, it's an Indian product. But it all started with people having ideas and expanding. So never say, you know, big or small. It's in you, what you can do and how you can implement it.
Ambassador, after your diplomatic days, you have spent time in several important positions covering Singapore's social and academic scene. You've been involved with a wide array of associations, whether it is towards social organizations or underprivileged organizations, or for that matter, even think tanks. What has been your motivation to be so involved after retirement? And more importantly, how do you decide what and where to get involved with?
What do you do after retirement? I play golf, but how much golf can you play? And then what do you do the rest of the day? You don't, I myself don't want to reach a stage where I get up in the morning and say, what do I do today? You know, so it has been helpful for me. I'm 85, so something will turn up, something will turn up. And we are able to do that. And there are any number of opportunities. For example, SINDA, Singapore Indian Development Association. We formed it because we wanted the lower strata to have the opportunities to rise above. And from there, we moved on to SICKI, to Singapore Indian Educational Fund, SIET. I'm also on that board where we help our people. So the opportunities are endless, is what you are able to. And it has been fun. I mean, I don't take myself seriously. So there's a lot of fun in it.
Ambassador, would you like to talk about your upcoming book?
Yeah. My book was launched, the English edition was launched 2 years ago. And the guest of honor was our foreign minister, Mr. Vivian Balakrishnan, a good friend of mine. So at the launch, and a gentleman came to me, Dr. Salim, and said, can I translate the book? So I knew Dr. Salim. He himself has written about 8 books. He's an expert on Thirukkural. His thesis was in Thirukkural. So when he approached me, I said, okay, why not? Then as we started on work on the book, I said, why a mere translation? You know, why just a mere translation? Why not a Tamil edition? And the Tamil edition allowed us, Dr. Salim and I, to venture into different areas and target it at the Indian and community and Tamil community. So the first thing I did, we did in this book, Thottathilirundhu, Thottapurathilirundhu Thoodharagam Varai. The title was given by Professor Thinnappan, who looked at it. He's our advisor to the book. The first thing I did was to go and see S.M. Tharman, Senior Minister Tharman, and say, talk to us about what the Indian community in Singapore will be, say, 25 years from now. He was quite intrigued and he gave us an interview, and that's the opening chapter. The second chapter is on SINDA, the development of the Indian community from bringing from bottoms up. So that has been the thing. Then I'm not going to, because you have to buy the book, so I'm not going to tell you all about it. The third one was very funny. I had gone to Chennai to attend a wedding, and 60th wedding anniversary of Sawaya. But before that, I launched my book in Chennai at the Madras Book Club. So after that, I decided to take a car, and we drove wherever we pleased. No itinerary. So we went from Chennai right to Rameshwaram. On the way, stopped at Thiruvannamalai. It went up to Dhanashkodi, then went back to Madurai, Karakuri, and flew back. Now, this allowed me, I did the same thing 30 years ago, but this time to Kanyakumari. So this allowed me to look at how much Tamil Nadu has progressed and the changes. And so that became part of the book called An Accidental and Unintended Journey. So it's what you make of a book, and this is what it is.
You were president for the Interreligious Council, IRO, from 2017 to 2018, and you continue to serve as a member of the IRO Council. What do you think are the key ingredients that make up for religious harmony? This is the first part of the question. And the second part is, we have Mr. Naveen Kolathur again with another interesting question that he wanted to ask of you. Mr. Naveen?
Thank you very much again, Ambassador. So I, you know, the context is my experience in Singapore as well, right? So I, as I said, do a lot, right? I think there is a lot that Singapore and India can learn from each other in terms of interracial harmony. And I would say, you know, Singapore has a much more structured approach, if I can use that term, than India. India is still pretty ad hoc, and you know, when things happen, it gets taken care. So, what are some of your views on what each country can learn from each other in terms of you know, this interracial harmony? How can we develop as a society, taking along everybody's view? Which are, you know, sometimes diagonally opposite.
Let me tell you, the seed for religious harmony came from India to Singapore. It came via a scholar, Maulana Siddiqui, who came from Calcutta and came to give a talk in Singapore. This was 70 years ago. 72 years ago. And at that point, at that time, it was still British rule. And he seeded this idea, why not have an inter-religious organization? So what we are doing is nothing, it's an Indian import, you know, Indian export, Singapore import. So over the years, we slowly, we became, firstly, we started off with religious tolerance. We tolerate each other. You have your own religion, you have your own way of doing things. From there, we move to religious understanding. We understand each other. Then we move from that to religious harmony, which is where we are at this moment. So it's a very evolutionary process. It can't be done. Now, came independence, the foundational stone of Singapore's nation building was religious harmony, interfaith, interracial, and lingual, multilingual policy. These were the foundational stones. So there you will find that religion was given. Each can practice his own religion, no problem. But at the same time, we had this IRO where people were able to mingle, etc. When I took over, I said we should go a step further. And we opened up each other's temples, churches, monasteries, the synagogues. So now, as a Singaporean, I'm completely at ease to go into a synagogue, completely at ease to go into a Taoist temple. No bus. And we also took some of the so, for example, Gurudwaras, you know, the free food, they say. The Buddhists give them. Now I'm working on the Hindu temples. We have about 20 Hindu temples. And each Hindu temple will be able to give food for anybody who comes. So the name tag is, no one shall go hungry in Singapore. You can go to the nearest the religious institution and say, I need food, you will be given. So there are ways. But again, you can do it in a small country. You can do it in a, but what is that to stop, say, Tamil Nadu practicing it, you know, and sharing it with the idea with the neighboring country? So it's again, we come back to what is possible, do what is possible, and hope for the best.
Ambassador, this brings us to the last question of our discussion. Singapore is one of India's top sources of FDI, foreign direct investment. What do you think India and Tamil Nadu in particular should do to further improve upon this in the time to come?
I think certainty of getting things done. We went in a big way. We have gone in a big way, you know, developing industrial estates and all. Our first one was in Bangalore. And we are prepared to go anywhere that we are called for. We will go and establish on a win-win situation. So Tamil Nadu has a lot of prospects. Here, I would like to make a suggestion. Tamil Nadu government should consider setting up an Institute of Policy Studies, dedicated Institute of Policy Studies, not aligned to any university or anything, not aligned to any political party, if I may say so, but it should be on its own. So it will be able to put out the ideas, programs, etc. This, I think, would be a major undertaking, and we can collaborate. Singapore has the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy. We can collaborate with that. We have the Rajaratnam School of International and Strategic Studies. We have IPS, which is more local oriented, which commissions studies. So at the moment, it's ad hoc. It's say, you know, somebody makes a visit, a delegation comes, delegation goes. Again, chambers are, you know, again, depending on the dynamism in the chambers. So one of the recommendations I would make is have a considered sui generis organization where long term, the chat has to be. Our Institute of Policy Study is now about 40 years old. And we look at different options. So that is my recommendation.
Very good. In fact, this current government has established the Economic Advisory Council, as you are also aware. That's a new step forward in the right direction, where they have noted economists as part of that. And we hope to be able to hear from them in the course of time about their progress made. Talking about policy studies, certainly I think that will also be a good thing to be able to put that in place. From a SICKY standpoint, we can certainly take the initiative and suggest it to the government. Ambassador, that brings us to an end of the discussion. Thank you very, very much for your time spent. Now we come to the new event that we have that we want to start from this session onwards. This was presented to us by the co-chair of the SICKY 360 team, Professor Murugavir. And this is called a quick fire round, Ambassador, where I'm going to give you 5 words. And I would like you to share with us one word that comes to your mind immediately when you hear this from me. So perhaps adding to the fun of the session. So can we go ahead, Ambassador?
Sure.
So the first one is, again, I'm only looking for one word that immediately comes to your mind in response to what I'm going to tell you. The first one is Singapore. Can you say that again? We couldn't hear you.
The name itself comes from Tamil Nadu.
Singapore.
The name itself, Singapore, has a linkage with Tamil Nadu. Singapore.
Okay. The second one is diplomat.
Man for all seasons.
Third is teaching.
Teaching. Learn all the time.
The fourth one is Benji.
There are 2 Benjis. I'll talk about the first one. Is it's a dog, a border collie.
That's what I meant, Ambassador.
Okay. It gave us so much. It gave us so much love and affection. It became the third son in the family. So.
And the last one is Miss Padmini.
She's a very, very dedicated to teaching. She was a wonderful teacher. And she was particularly keen on teaching of children with special needs.
Thank you very, very much, Ambassador, for that candid exchange. We enjoyed having you. Wonderful points you shared with us today. Certainly time well spent. As a part of the SICKY 360 format, we would like you to autograph your photograph so that we can save it with us. We will have it sent to you at the earliest. And if you can please autograph it along with today's date, we would certainly appreciate it. Also, Ambassador, as a token of our appreciation of you having spent time with us, as new as what 360 is, the 360 team has come up with an effective way of recognizing our guests. There is what is known as the Kanchi Kamakoti Child's Trust Hospital in Chennai. And this hospital has been providing EOMAN service for decades together. They specialize in children. It's a pediatric-oriented hospital. And specifically, they address children from underprivileged families who cannot afford it. So we have taken the liberty, Ambassador, to contribute in your name to this worthy cause. So the necessary fund will go towards meeting a underprivileged child's medical expenditure. This is a certificate from the hospital, and we will also have this sent to you at the earliest opportunity, Ambassador. Thank you again. I would like to take this opportunity to also thank for today's session Mr. Pong Kok Tian, who is the Consul General of Singapore in Chennai. And I would also like to thank Mr. R. Rajaram of NUS Singapore for having assisted us with today's session. Of course, we would like to thank our event sponsor, Sri City, for having partnered with us in this SIKI 360 series. I would now like to take this opportunity to thank the SIKI 360 series itself, the SIKI 360 team. This team is led by Mrs. Valli Arun, who's the president of the Velingro Group and trustee of the Tamil Isai Sangam. Bhavani, can we please have the next slide? Bhavani? Yes, thank you. This team is co-chaired by Professor T. Murugavel, who's the head of the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences at SVCE Chennai. Mr. Vinod Solomon represents the secretariat into the SIKI 360 committee. We have Mr. Gokul Santanam, who is Senior Vice President of Emphasis, who leads the marketing efforts of SIKI 360. Mr. Amalan Alavandar, who is Environment Consultant at the Asian Development Bank, plays the role of online moderating the chat session and feeds it to us for answering. We have Ms. Vilasni M. Arun, who is a student of clinical psychology and brings in the student focus into the SIKI 360 committee. Having said that, I would now like to, as I mentioned earlier, share with you that we have since completed the first anniversary of SIKI 360. We have had 12 wonderful sessions so far. We started this program in October of 2020, and every month we've had a session continuously. For those of you who might be aware, we started with Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, Chief Scientist of the World Health Organization. Session 2 was with Dr. C. Rangarajan, who was the ex-governor of the Reserve Bank of India. As I said earlier, we had Dr. V. Shanta of the Cancer Institute, who joined us in December. Our session 4 was with Mr. Sridhar Vembu, who is CEO and founder of Zoho Corporation. Session 5 was with Mr. Vishwanathan Anand, a 5-time grandmaster, chess grandmaster. We had Dr. A.C. Muthaya for session 6, and that was followed by Mr. Gopal Krishna Gandhi for session 7, where he also shared his book about Mahatma Gandhi with us. We had next as Mr. A. Kalyamurthy, a famous orator, motivator, and a police officer who was particularly interesting for the student community. We reached out to the Malaysian, the Tamil diaspora in Malaysia with our session with Tan Sri Dato, Dr. R. Palan. That was followed up by Dr. Pratap C. Reddy, who is founder of Apollo Hospitals. And last month, we had Dr. Mrs. Meena Muthaya, who's founder of Chetnad Vidyashram. We're extremely glad that we had with us today Ambassador K. Kesavapani. So that summed up our first anniversary of these 12 sessions that we've had month on month. Next slide, please, Bhavani. Again, an extremely successful 12 sessions since October and running continuously without a break. Each of our guests have been globally renowned and have spanned industry, healthcare, education, diplomats, police, and the sports segments. Among our guests, we've had four Padma Vibhushans, 2 Padma Shris, 1 Padma Shri, and 2 Padma Bhushans. We have, in the process, attracted a new and wide audience that has spanned industry, society at large, as well as the student community. We've also made sure that we've evolved every session, keeping up with the time and the context. Our guests have been, each of our guests have been, have made sure that they have contributed to social causes, or rather we have contributed in our guests' names to various social causes that has enabled SIKI to have a good initiative going. Though this SIKI 360 concept appears to be easy today, There has been a magnificent teamwork that has gone on in the background that has been driven by robustness and vibrancy. I would like to take this opportunity to thank the audience for their support. The maximum that we've had so far has been 365 people joining us for any session. We would congratulate the excellent and regenerating teamwork of the SICKI 360 team. We are now going into full vigor into the second year. We've already got the next programs identified. And as always, we are open for suggestions at any point of time. I would like to take this opportunity to raise a second toast for today to the SICKI 360 series. I would like to thank the guest speakers. I would like to thank the audience. And I would also like to thank the SICKI 360 team for a job well done. Thank you. Friends, I'd like to share with you that the next SICKI 360, which is session 13, has already been scheduled. This is going to be with Mrs. Sivasankari, who's a noted author and an activist. This is scheduled for Thursday, October 21st at 4:30 p.m. IST. It's again going to be held online over our WebEx platform. We request you to please mark your calendars and do join us for this program. That brings us to an end of today's session. Thank you again very much for joining us, and we certainly look forward to your ongoing participation with us. I would like to take this opportunity to wish everybody safe times ahead. Nandri, vanakkam.